Patiently. This is said, we start our class, the Fiqh al-Da'wah. The flyer that we have distributed, we called it What Every Student of Know Must Know, really from the system of Islam. The idea to start with this, of course, after Bismillah wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah, is to really draw the attention how important first to know the system of Islam before talking about Islam. We need to know the foundation, the principles, what is Islam in reality. Many of the people, they inherit Islam as the legacy that they grew up with or they heard about. They really base their behavior, their ruling, their thinking, their you know, presumption on many of the rules or many of the ruling based on what they have heard when they were young or what they have, you know, seen. Therefore, most of the Muslims, they do not know Islam. And talking about the system of Islam is the really way of the aspect of inviting to Islam. Therefore, when we talk about the Fiqh al-Da'wah, it will not be possible to talk, make da'wah if we do not know the foundation of the system of Islam. And alhamdulillah, I mean, one of the best book in inspiring the techniques and the way of the da'wah that's being called the roots or the usul of a da'wah has been written by an eminent scholar. He died not long ago. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower him with his mercy. Is Dr. Abdul Karim Zaidan. Abdul Karim Zaidan. That will be the main book that you're going to be inspiring from, inshallah ta'ala. The book he divided, yes. For the... Okay. The cord is short, so... For you to... Well, this is for you, inshallah, to take care of it. The book is divided in two parts. The first part is talking about the system of Islam. The second part is talking about the da'iyah himself and his strategy, how to look at you know, the environment around him and how he will be making plans. And before that, it will be what are the moral requirements for the da'iyah. Because in the introduction, we're going to study some element who's going to be helping us as, let's say, principles for the study that we're going to be sharing together, inshallah ta'ala. I will start in the introduction. This is, inshallah, I will be starting a new class on the Schoology, share with you, bi'idhnillah ta'ala, the code that you can access it. And you will find all these notes. So this, for example, here the introduction. Then we'll have the part one, understanding the system, the Islamic system, the pillars of the Islamic system. We're always talking about the pillars of Islam. We're talking about the pillars of the Islamic system. Then we're talking about the subsystem of Islam. One of the most important things that we're going to study is the characteristic of the Islam. What are the characteristics? When talking about characteristic of Islam, what are the things that characterize the system of Islam? Why Islam is relevant? Why Islam is universal? Why Islam is everlasting? We do not, you know, defend Islam because we love Islam. We defend Islam beyond the aqidah that we have and the submission we have to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We defend Islam because it's the truth. What are the evidence that show that Islam is the truth, and so on. So talking about the characteristics of Islam, we might extend a little bit in this topic to look at it even from point of view of aqidah, point of view of aqidah, and point of view of a system. So when you say the characteristic of Islam, which is mean that there's none other system, no other system that will resemble Islam in its way, in its structure, because he has his unique characteristic. Then the subsystem of Islam, to see how the Islam, organized the society in a very coherent way to when we're talking about the Rahmah, how the Rahmah will be, spread in the whole society, touching every subject and every part of the universe. Therefore, you have to have a system of implementation. How the system of implementation is done, is organized, is preserved, is executed from the governmental, point of view, from the social point of view, to see how the ahkam of the Sharia comes to embrace the whole systems from the individual to the community to the whole society. And after that, we come to the way of the Dawah. So these, inshallah, you will have these notes available for you بإذن الله تعالى. We start with the introduction, and of course, we start with the element that it's required really to start with it in every topic, which is the Islamic vision of life. The Islamic vision of life constitute for us the foundation of our creed, of our views. It's going to be the foundation of our conceiving, of our analysis. It is the condition, this Islamic vision of life is going to be the basis of our feeling, of our thinking, of our emotions. The first thing, and maybe we had, studied this more in details when we had done the class of the Sirah, because it was changing and molding the life of the first generation, we had to go more in details. Here I'll go through some points, and then if you have any question or comment, inshallah, we can have that, inshallah. So he's saying, here قال, the Islamic vision to the existence, the world of the unseen and the seen, the witnessed. So here the first thing that we start with, there's two worlds that we live in. The world that we see, that we witness, and the world behind, a scene that we don't see. Now, the people, for example, when we're talking about people with no belief, atheists, they only limit themselves, their analysis, their vision, their planning, their project, everything is the world of the scene. However, the word of the unseen is a part of the life of the believer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us, عَالِمُ الْغَيْبِ وَالشَّهَادَ. And the first aspect to help the believer be guided or get on the path of the guidance is that believe in the unseen. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the beginning of his book, قَالَ ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. هُدَلْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. There's no doubt in this book, guidance to the pious one. Who are the pious one? أَلَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Those who believe in the unseen. So the unseen is the word that comes for us before the seen, before what we witness. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, don't you see? أَلَمْ تَرَى. Our certainty in what Allah is saying more in what we see with our own eyes. Because your eye might trick you to give you an information that is not true. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called it, khairatul ayn. You might see things, you imagine that it were like presume something, but in reality it's not. Therefore, in Islam, with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the unseen becomes the guide of the seen. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you, it becomes your basis and your foundation to be guided and treat with the thing that you have. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling you, given the sake of Allah, I'll increase your wealth. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saying in the dua, in the hadith, قال والذي نفسي بيده لا ينقص مال من صدقة. By the one who holding my soul, wealth does not decrease by the fact that you give sadaqah. In the scene, in what you witness, if you have $100 and give $50 as a sadaqah, you have a balance of $50. In the unseen, you have a balance more than $100. So this is the guidance. So it becomes like you trust and rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more on than relying on what you have in your balance account or in your pocket. So this is the first aspect in the vision of life that the believer or the da'iyah has to put as a foundation in his vision, as a foundation in his view of this life. People, they panic, they get scared because some aspect of they see or they go through, when the believer, he will find, you know, totally different. Why? Because he has another aspect that he believes in. The example, there's many examples. The example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu in Ghari Hira, in Ghari Thawr. I mean, the disbelievers led by Abi Jahl, they were at the entrance of the cave. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he say to Abi Bakr? قال, لا تحزن إن الله معنا. Do not be sad. The one who live and view the world only restricted in the realm of the seen, he will already have, you know, he would have died maybe out of fear. And Abu Bakr, he has the same view because he's a follower of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, of his life, of the vision of his life. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he didn't tell him, don't be scared. He said, don't be sad. Because Abu Bakr, he was not frightened. He know that the cause that he's defending, that he's standing for, is the cause of the truth. But he was sad. If Allah will for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to his life to end it then, so he said about Islam that he is not going to be spread. قَالَ لَا تَحْزَنْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasized the fact that he said, Allah sent junud armies that you don't see. You see the unseen that you don't see. وَأَيَّدَهُ بِجُنُودٍ لَمْ تَرَوْهَا. And Allah helped him, sent to him as enforcement around him, soldier that you don't see. This is the unseen. Now, if you talk to someone who does not believe in such a thing, like one time I was listening to an atheist, I mean, talking in kind words, not being rude, he said, I respect, you know, of course, talking with other faith, not with Muslim. He said, I respect, you know, the people of faith. But for me, when people, for example, they're talking about angels, as long as they don't bring it to a lab to see it, to analyze it, then I cannot believe in it. And this is, subhanAllah, how someone will lose his own self by kind of being stubborn in not trying to understand, because the unseen is more seen than the true witness seen. If we just reflect, I mean, people, some people they call it miracle, other people they call it coincidence, and everyone want to give an interpretation. What it's there is clear. You just, if someone open his heart by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, and the leave of Allah, then he can see this unseen. So this is the first principle as an introduction in the defining the Islamic vision of life. So it is the unseen which is guiding our way to deal with the seen, with the thing that we witness. There's many ayat. I mean, we can take a long time, you know, about this point, but there's many ayat. I'll conclude with the ayah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Talaq. قَالَ وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيُرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. Whoever who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, guard his way and fear Allah and be self-sustained, guarding the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and observing Allah's laws, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make a way from him, make a way out for him and provide him from way that he would not expect. In this ayah is telling you that the increase of provision is related to the taqwa. It's not related to the effort that you put at work, for example. It's not related in the number of hours that you work. And this is truly the unseen. This is truly the unseen. And between the way or the aspect to have ourselves trusting in the unseen, or being observing the scene in a way to be inclined ourselves, we've been inclined to deal with the scene. Because we know if I give $5, is it reduced from my money? But how can I have that certainty that what I give is really increase in provision? And that is the struggle for the believer to gain that piety. So as a da'iyah, and if we're talking about the moral requirement, start from the first point. Because if we do not have that trust, that sincere reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, therefore our way of da'wah for ourselves, for our surrounding, for close one to us, it will be really shaky and it does not have that strong foundation. The second point, death is not the end of the journey. Death is a step in the journey of existence. And this is a very important point. Death is not the end of the journey. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this many times in the Quran. So one of the aspects that we need to have always present in our spirit, in our mind, that the more you see things in the Quran, they're not like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeat them just to remind them. It's to repeat them as being part of our life, as being something that need to be embedded in our spirit, which is mean that it need to be a main factor in our decision, in our planning. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about the disbeliever, that the life, it ends by death. That's it. Not the life, actually, the existence ceases at death. When death, subhanAllah, is the beginning of the true life. Therefore, the believer, he knows, that's why before analyzing or making judgment on things like what happened, 2 days ago in New Zealand, to put it in perspective, it's like you say, this is a step in their life. It's not the end. And this is a change the way even how you think, the way how you analyze, the way even how you're going to formulate your statement. Death is not the end of the journey. Death is a step in the journey of the existence. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us to live forever. And this is a change the way how we think. A reminder that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran that every human being, he goes through 5 stages. A stage before our coming here, a stage in this life, because the soul existed before even we were born. A stage in the grave, which is, we call it the life of the grave. Stage in the day of judgment, at the resurrection. And the day of judgment, all of you know, it's a day that equal to the life of the whole earth, of the universe. So it's not like one day. Therefore, if you think about it, in the count of Allah, is the whole life on this earth is one day, and then you have the second day, the day of judgment, and then the eternity. So the stages of life, which is, therefore, you find yourself as a human being, you've been created by Allah for the eternity. And this has really helped in the aspect of the da'wah. For the people, when you talk to them in this perspective, they look, then you give them totally different perspective of life. Then they will listen. Why? Because you're giving them, subhanAllah, a new hope in a life that for them is being determined and very restricted in this very short life, where the whole competition, the whole race is limited to a life very random. They don't know where they're going to die. That's why the race becomes the happiest person will be the one who dies with a lot of toys. But the happiest person in the vision of Islam, the one who's been admitted in the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Which ayah is this?
Inshallah, here is. Is it Surah Al-Baqarah? Ayah 28. How can you disbelieve in Allah when you were lifeless? That's the first stage. And He brought you to life. Second stage. And He will cause you to die. That's the third stage in the grave. Then He will bring you back. That's the fourth stage. And then to Him you will return. That's the fifth stage. 28, he said in the Arabic, he said, you were dead and you kuntum amwatan. So that's the translation, which is mean you were amwat, and amwat does not mean absence of existence. Amwat, it means you were in a stage where actually al-mawtu is kind of stage when you don't have the free will. So it's a state of existence, but there's no that action like we do now in life. No, before that, we were soul. I can show you. I can show you an ayah in the Quran that Allah witnessed and brought us to witness on His oneness just when He created it. Here. You see here, seeing that you were without life. In the other one, he says, see that you were dead. So death in Islam is not nothingness, is not absence of existence. It exists, but in different realm. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say He causes us to die when we go to sleep. When we are asleep, we are dead. As He said in Surah Az-Zumar. Develop on what you have said in Surah Al-A'raf. Allah talking to the whole humankind when He, the only one existed in as physical existence, as we know, is Adam only. Look what He said here. And surely we gave you authority on earth and appointed for you therein provisions, right? And then look what Allah said, and surely we created you. Now this, the parenthesis is not in the Quran. And then gave you shape. Then we told the angel prostrate to Adam. So the action that is being done, all the offspring of Adam was with Adam. But the soul of every one of us already existed before Adam. And I'll give you another ayah, which give you more more clarity, inshallah. In Surah Al-A'raf, the same surah. Here. And mention when your Lord took from the children of Adam, from their loins, their descendants, and made them testify of themselves, saying to them, am I not your Lord? They said, yes, we have testified. And this is what is, when you say every human is born on Islam, that's from where it comes. From where it came. So the light of Islam is already embedded because we already gave our witness to Allah that He is our Lord. And this is here the ayah 7172. And remember when you wrote, brought forth from the children of Adam, from their loins, their seed. And made them testify as to themselves, saying, am I not your Lord? So he have them to come, subhanAllah, in the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, to have them testify. But the existence as soul already existed before Adam. In Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah only, Allah knows subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that.
I just wanted to narrow that gap. Maybe you know, but I don't. So when it says in this ayat that you know, am I not your Lord? Or no? And when your Lord took the children of Adam from their loins, their descendants, and made them testify of themselves, saying to them, am I not your Lord? They said, yes, we have testified. Lest you should say on the day of resurrection, we were of this unaware. So my question is that, like obviously, like I don't remember, right? We don't remember, we don't know. So that gap right there, how do we
fill
that gap?
But the gap is not accountable. Because when he said, in the day of judgment, we don't remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent for them messengers to remind them, to guide them.
That's
Because anyone in this life who didn't have a message or didn't get the message, he will not be banished. I'll give you the evidence. Surah Al-Isra. In Surah Al-Isra, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, وَمَا كُنَّ مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا. So that's that instant of being a Muslim within the self as in the creation of Allah, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, in Surah Ar-Rum, فِطْرَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَطَرَ النَّاسَ عَلَيْهَا. It's the creation of Allah on which, or on base of which, Allah created, originated human being on it. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah, if we can talk about the gap here, قال, whoever is guided is only guided for the benefit of his soul, and whoever errs only errs against it. And no bearer of burden will bear the burden of another, and never will we punish until we sent a messenger. It's clear. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not, if there is no warner to remind you, to guide you, but the guidance, it comes, for example, if there's anyone who want to take one species and turn it to a different species. If someone developed, take a donkey to turn it into a plane. That will be possible. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us, for a person to become a Muslim and guided, because he had the element of guidance embedded within the self. Can we have an animal be guided to pray or to do things or to do the taklif? He cannot, because he does not have those elements, those foundations, so he will not be able to. So the guidance of the messenger to invite, because the person or the one called, he already have that covenant being taken 4 times ago. So he had it inside. That's why I always say this example. People, when they come to Islam, we ask them, why did you come to Islam? They say, it makes sense. That sense is the witness. Why it makes sense? Because if we didn't have that foundation, if it was not embedded, there people, no one will have been guided. No one will have been guided. You cannot guide animals to do the da'wah, except if Allah will, like for the dabba that will come. But the dabba actually is a miracle to say, to proclaim things, but it's not a guide or anything like that.
The unseen ayat, I was thinking, but during the when Israel, when they said,
نرى الله جهر.
So, are they also men like that, or is, what makes them feel like they have to see Allah, even though they have prophets to them? You know, like, even why they have, like, if they say, I have to see something before I can believe it.
You can ask them in the Day of Judgment. You know, the scholar of the tafsir, they say it was an envy. They were envying Musa alayhi salam, because they were elders. And Musa, Allah talked to him, and then they become like stubborn. You know, and Banu Israel, they have a very kind of a defect in the creed, which is the connection to God. They had it always through what they can touch. So even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helping them to submit, he said, "Udhkuru ni'mat Allah." Remember the gift of Allah on you. Things that they have touched, that they have seen. Now, to transcend them to the unseen, it was a big challenge. So when they came and Musa alayhi salam, why he's talking to Musa and not to us? Then it's kind of being stubborn and rebelling, said, we're not going to believe in you. We want us to follow. We want to see God. One of the other aspects, to be fair, living in a society for a long time, a pagan society, it has an effect on the generation and the way how they think. They lived for generation among the Pharaon people who they were pagans. They used to see their gods all the time. For them, they have that you know, difficulties how to transcend, you know, toward the God they don't see, sent by Musa. They sing the miracle, they sing things, but they always coming back to that, you know, weakness that it grow within themselves while they've been, you know, all this time in the in a society of paganism. You see them, for example, they said to Musa, when Fir'aun inflicted more persecution and torture after the coming of Musa, they said, it's like you didn't change anything. You've been harmed before you come, and we've been harmed again after you came. So they didn't have that aspect of sabr. Then as soon as Musa left, you see what they did. They took the calf. Why? Because they want something to see. So that... that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this whole ayat, after a whole chapter talking about this type of creed and the weakness that they had, which has led them to the deviation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to transcend from the scene to say, "Udhkuruni adhkurkum." Remember me, I remember you. He didn't say, remember my gifts, I remember. He said, remember me.
Contradicts, like, it contradicts, like, how people of our prophets, ask them,
you know, I mean, they accept the prophet. I mean, people that become the prophet of the first generation accept it easily that way, but Israel, you know, takes so
much. You know, not sure that they accept it easily, by the way. I mean, the prophet didn't accept him easy, right?
Yeah.
I mean, and if the prophet comes today, they will not. I mean, Isa alayhi salam, when he's going to come back, they're not going to accept him. Why? Because they already have described the one that they want. If he comes different of what they already want, then he's going to be the wrong one. And that's the meaning of submission in Islam. The submission is to submit to the revelation to tell you and define for you all the aspects of your life. But the opposite of it is like you define what you want and then you want the revelation to validate what you want. That's the problem. So we'll take a break, we'll go pray Asr and come back inshallah. We'll meet you right after Asr.